she leave you lost and lonely? Did she lie, 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 lie? I'm not like the other ones. No, 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 no. Oh, I'm not like the other ones. No, 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 no. You won't find another one. No, 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 no.
Thank you all so much. How's everyone doing? This is fantastic. I'm so excited to be here. That first song was actually an original song that I wrote called The Other One. And I'm gonna dive in to my story. So I remember when I heard NPR's TED Radio Hour talk by Reshima Soojani, who actually spoke here last year, about the staggering statistic that men apply for a job when they meet only 60% of the qualifications, but women apply only if they meet 100% of them. One Forbes article summed it up as, men are confident about their ability at 60%, but women don't feel confident until they've checked off each item off the list. Now, I can see why women would feel this way, but it's never been the way I've lived my life. Mainly because life has thrown me some pivotal opportunities in my career that have come to fruition by embracing risk. I grew up being pretty shy in certain regards, and had I not been put into these situations, I probably would as well support this statistic. So today, I wanted to share with all of you a few stories about challenging things that have come up in my career and diving into the deep end. I remember the moment when the phone rang in my house, and it was my composition teacher. He was so excited, and he said, "Keith Lockhart from the Boston Pops Orchestra is talking about you on the radio." It was so out of the blue for me, and I had certainly never met Mr. Lockhart before. And the Boston Pops Orchestra, they're one of the greatest orchestras in the world. So this is so exciting. So not too long after that call, the Boston Pops people got a hold of me, inviting me to perform with the orchestra at Symphony Hall. And by the way, I was 14 years old. So, okay, Symphony Hall, 2,000 people, orchestra, this is so exciting and it's brand new for me. Fast forward to the day that I met with Keith Lockhart to talk about repertoire. I was so excited, and he's very handsome in person. he already had some great idea for feature materials and repertoire, and then he mentioned to me he'd love to feature me as a composer, because he knew that I wrote, and he said, we'll break it down into your usual four-piece group. Well, right after he proposed that thought, little Grace said to him, well, Mr. Lockhart, I'd love it if the whole orchestra could play with me. And he said, well, Grace, they're going to need parts. To which I replied, well, do you think I could write the parts? And I think this is the part that he looked at me like I had four heads. And he said, have you ever done that before? And I said, no. And he said, well, why don't you start by writing something? But I need to tell you, this is the Boston Pops, and it does need to be perfect. But go ahead and start. And if it's not up to, you know, what it needs to be by the time of the performance, then we'll go back to my plan and break it down into a four-piece group. Now, honestly, in my head, I was thinking, why should I keep it a small quartet if the whole orchestra is just going to sit this one out? But I don't think it really sunk in about how big of a task this would be until Mr. Lockhart said the words to me, this has to be perfect. This is the Boston Pops Orchestra. I mean, this is like cooking for a giant group of people and say Anthony Bourdain sitting at the table and the only thing you've cooked before is macaroni and cheese for four people. So the next six weeks were filled with nothing but orchestration books, guidance from my composition teacher, and my head nearly exploding. There was excitement in learning so much new information, but to be quite honest with you, it was daunting because I was in this crazy time crunch, and there were plenty of moments where I was just so close to giving it all up. But in the back of my head, I kept thinking, hey, what is the worst that could happen? The worst that could happen, like Mr. Lockhart had said, is we'd break it down into a four-piece group. So with that in mind, I persevered, and I had amazing cheerleaders behind me, my parents and my composition teacher. So 6 weeks later, a cabin-fevered Grace, 40 pages, and a week before the concert, and I meet with Mr. Lockhart, and he looks through my score. Now, this is the moment of yay or nay, and I've been working my butt off. And he looks at me, and he looks at the score, and he says, this looks good. Let's try it next week. Okay, well, next week rolls around. We're at Symphony Hall getting ready for dress rehearsal, and this would be the first time that I'd hear my score played with real instruments, because up to this point, I've only heard it as MIDI computer sound. So I am so freaking nervous, and my heart is in my chest, and I am just praying that this is not going to sound like complete mush. And the good news is, it didn't. I will even go on to say it was pretty darn good for my debut orchestration. You can see our picture here. So we performed the next two nights at Symphony Hall for 2,000 people each night, and I was in absolute musical heaven. I think it's so easy to get hung up on perfection, the idea of knowing exactly how to do something and telling oneself, I'm not ready, this is way too big. I often, very often, get hung up on the details as well, but I learned from this experience about jumping in and just learning on the go, because there never will be a perfect time to start. But as long as you just start, you'll figure it out, and you're one step closer. When I was 16 years old, a couple years later, I made a trip to New York City with my family. And there was a big concert happening at the Apollo Theater. It was a jazz concert. The woman who was producing the show said she could get me in and get me backstage, so I was super excited. Well, last minute, found out that the show was completely sold out and she couldn't get me in. So I was quite disappointed. but my family and I changed course, and we decided to go eat at Roth's Steakhouse, which is a very casual steakhouse in Midtown. So there was a great piano trio playing in the corner, and they were a friend of a friend, and the pianist said to me, hey, why don't you come sit in? So I played the first set with them, super, super fun, and then he said, we're going to take a break. Why don't you come back for the second set and play with us some more if you're down. And by the way, we have a trumpeter who's going to join us. So I was delighted. And so I'm playing the second set. There's no trumpeter in sight. And then in the middle of my solo, I open my eyes. And in the back door walks none other than Wynton Marsalis. Yeah. So my jaw, I mean, like, have to keep my jaw together because I'm playing, but I want to drop it. And Wynton walks in with his son. And there's like 10 people at Roth Steakhouse, and they seem so much more interested in eating their steaks than like Wynton Marsalis. So anyways, he takes his trumpet out, and we start jamming together. And I'm thinking in the back of my head, that's the trumpeter you were referring to? Oh my God. And we play a second set, and it's so fun, and it's incredibly like pinch me surreal. Well, a few weeks later, my father gets a call from Wynton's people asking if I'd be his special guest with his orchestra at Rose Hall in New York City for 3 nights. There we are. Okay, so that's us at Roth Steakhouse. And then here we are. This is at Rose Hall. And then that led him to ask if I'd join a whole cast of legendary musicians to celebrate Obama's first inauguration at the Kennedy Center. What an opportunity. I am so excited. I'm sweating. I'm terrified. I remember the weeks leading up to the performance, and I'm an anxious mess. I knew I was so excited about it, but at the same time, there was just this feeling of dread in my gut because I was so nervous. So the day rolls around. The who's who of jazz is there. I find out I'm playing a song with the Dave Brubeck, the legendary pianist, and it's just all pretty crazy. Performance time rolls around. My heart is beating up in my throat until the moment that I step on stage. Something magical always happens the minute that I'm on stage. That's why I love it up here. As soon as I play my first note, it's like all my anxiety goes away. And I am just in it. I'm in the music, and it's the most glorious feeling in the world. It's my zen, my meditation, and everything else just floats away. So I walked off the stage with a big grin. I was ready for it, and after I got on stage, I could thoroughly enjoy it. And I kept thinking in my head, this can't be harder than writing for the Boston Pops Orchestra. Well, I think back to that night at Roth Steakhouse and how none of this would have happened if the initial plan of going to see that performance at the Apollo Theater came through. And instead, I decided to embrace being spontaneous, going with the flow, and changed plans. And we ended up at Roth Steakhouse, and something better than I could have ever imagined happened. So go figure. Well, I have one last story for all of you about a very unexpected, challenging, and thrilling experience that I had a lot more recently. So it's December of 2015. I'm visiting New York City from Santa Monica, California, which is where I was living. It's freezing. I'm in a cab in Midtown, and I get a text from my friend John Batiste. John's an amazing musician from New Orleans, and we've worked together in different musical capacities over the years, but I hadn't heard from him in a while. Now, September of that year, he started a brand new gig as the band leader for The Late Show with Stephen Colbert. So I get a text from him, and it says, hey, Grace, do you play clarinet and baritone saxophone? And what other instruments do you play? This is like so out of the blue. And to be honest, I have not played the clarinet since fourth grade, where it deeply scarred me, and I swore to myself I would never play it again and begged my parents to get me a saxophone. And I have not played the baritone saxophone since eighth grade, and that's a huge instrument. It's like 25 pounds. But I'm thinking in the back of my head, maybe this has to do with the Late Show for the future, so I should start practicing these instruments now to get ready for the future. Now, my parents have always raised me, and from the musical experiences I've had and talked about, to say yes as much as possible, because that brings in all these new, amazing opportunities in my life. So with that in mind, I said, yes, I do. And I also play alto sax and soprano, and I sing and percussion and keys. Why do you ask? Okay, so the next text he writes goes, cool, what are you doing in 3 days? Want to join us on the late show for 1 week? Oh my God. So I'm like, what? This is amazing. What an opportunity. And then I'm like, oh my God. I just told him I played instruments that I don't play. And 3 days? Are you kidding me? Okay, so, but I wrote back, yes, because I couldn't pass up this opportunity. So next thing, try to prepare. Now, he didn't tell me any music we would be playing. He didn't say, I'll send you some PDFs, none of that. So I had no idea. It was just show up on Monday. Also, I didn't have the horns. I told you, it was a really quick trip. So I called Yamaha Instruments. I've been endorsing their horns for the last year. And they said, Grace, take a deep breath. This is fantastic. We'll get you in the studio tomorrow, and we'll hook you up with all of the horns. Okay, cool. Next thing, try to get good at the clarinet and baritone saxophone in 3 days. Now, I don't know if any of you play woodwinds, but the clarinet is such a beast, and it is not like the saxophone. And you just can't get good at anything in 3 days. I mean, I have background of the saxophone, of course, but this was so daunting. And the baritone saxophone is a very big instrument. It's, I'm pressing the wrong button. Okay. It's a very big instrument. This is me with the woodwind. So it's a 25-pound instrument, and so I'm going crazy the next 3 days trying to learn these things with no music sent. I go on YouTube, and I'm, like, searching Stephen Colbert Late Show to find all the past episodes. I learn the theme song. I'm going back to old music I've played with John, just hoping that, like, that might be some of the material. I don't know. So Monday rolls around. I'm nervous. I'm really nervous. I can't sleep the night before. I'm worried I won't hear my alarm. I roll up to the Ed Sullivan Theater. The set is, like, beautiful. The production is crazy. They're introducing me to their makeup department and wardrobe, and there's giant cameras, and it's just, like, all so new. And I'm wearing these in-ear monitors, which are, like, ear molds that I hear, like, Stephen Colbert's voice, and John has a special talkback mic that only the band hears, and then I hear, like, production voices. So I'm, like, getting used to that as well. Okay, so it's just about showtime. Stephen Colbert walks onto the stage. The crowd is going nuts, and the cameras are, like, the guy's counting down, and I'm feeling like this headless chicken, but having to keep this very calm demeanor and smile. Meanwhile, I still have no idea what we're going to play. I'm serious. Like, we learned the theme song, and then John went over a few other, like, little ideas, but it was all so vague. The thing about him is John is one of the most spontaneous people I've ever met, and in our past performances together, he never has a set list. I don't know why I was thinking for national television it would be different. But it wasn't. So, okay, here I am having no idea what we're about to play. Cameras are going. And we come into the first commercial break. So I watch the cameras, these giant things, start to, like, pan towards the band. And then I hear John in my ear go, Grace, grab the clarinet, grab the clarinet. Get on the blacktop, get on the blacktop. And I have no idea what the blacktop is. So in a state of panic, I look over to one of the other band members and I mouth, like, what's the blacktop? And he points to the front of the stage, and so I grab the clarinet, and I go to the front, the camera's in my face, and this is the moment I was praying would not happen. I was really hoping that John would just forget that I play the clarinet and just let me play the saxophone. But there I am, and in that moment, all I could do was take a deep breath, jump in, and say, you got it, you got this, and so I played. And the next thing I hear in my ear is John saying, trade with me, trade with me. Now, he's this crazy virtuosic pianist. So he starts playing. And I'm like. Oh, my God. So somehow we got through it. It's all kind of a haze to me. And after the performance, I had all the band and the production crew, they're all coming up to me saying, that was incredible, what a great solo, we didn't know you played all these instruments. And that 1 week stint turned into an incredible 6 months with the band. Oh, thank you. And I got better at the clarinet and baritone. So, you know, our brains are so powerful, and in that moment of jumping in and soloing on a foreign instrument, it would have been so easy to prepare for the worst, to give up before even trying, and to let my nerves get the best of me. Well, there have been studies done about groups of athletes and musicians who rehearse their moves in their heads before, and it being just as effective as the group who go through the actual physical motions. So in that moment of jumping in, the decision to succeed before I even played my solo was probably just as important as physically playing it. What do they say? They say, fake it till you make it. Now, what you don't know, and that I've never said publicly before, is that I used to deal with a lot of anxiety. In my quiet space, I developed self-inflicting pain habits, and my minor OCD became more obsessive. And it was silent pain, nobody else could see it. And on stage, I could still be who I truly was, but inside, I was really battling this terrible mind game. I remember back in high school when I was part of these all-star, invite-only music programs, hundreds would apply, and only 12 of us would get in. Excitement came with it, but I also got my first glimpse into the gossip and the put-downs that would float around the music world, and especially among my peers. And I honestly don't think any of us enjoy being in that vulnerable state, but to a 14-year-old girl who was surrounded by all dudes, this hit extra hard. I've always been a super happy person, and I love to bring good vibes wherever I go. So this period where negative energy started to eat away at me, and all of a sudden, you know, I was noticing this artistic bubble of everybody saying, you know, it's all about me, and I'm so much better than them. Why did they get that? And that was just never natural for me. I knew from experiences I had with performing live and from my mentors that encouragement and positivity were things that I resonated with. But man, I battled with these thoughts. I battled with the thoughts of others tearing each other down instead of lifting each other up. And the more I thought about competition and scarcity, the worse my anxiety and OCD would become. But the moments I was truly at peace was when I was on stage making music or burying my head in an orchestration book. That was when I was utterly captivated and curious and content. It was in those moments that I was focusing on the most important thing, the music. And when I stripped away that little devil on my shoulder that kept bringing up thoughts of everyone else and comparisons and thoughts of failure, I could finally feel a little bit more free. And I realized if I could just do this for myself, if I could be 100% into the music and do the very best I could do in that moment, I could be proud of myself, because after all, the music is so much bigger than all of us as individuals. Well, the exciting thing is there were opportunities that came into my life that spoke to that new path of thinking. Like when I was 18, the US Embassy sent me to Madagascar to be a musical ambassador, and it was an incredible trip. I was making music with the locals, and hipping them to who Louis Armstrong was. We were sharing all these smiles together. And it felt bigger than just one performance. It was worlds coming together, and interaction, and music, and light bulb moments. Well, fast forward to this past year, and I was gifted with another incredible opportunity with a lot of those feelings. I was asked to perform at an annual gala for a nonprofit called She's the First. I met the co-founder years ago when I was a winner for Glamour Magazine's Top 10 College Women. She's the First is an amazing nonprofit that supports girls' education all around the world, especially low-income countries. Well, when they asked me to be their featured performer, I dove a lot deeper into what they do, and I was so, so inspired. I was inspired by the lives that they had directly touched and how every day this core team would go to work for others, and they would give, give, give. Their positive change was undeniable, and all I knew was that I wanted to be a part of that. I write songs about people and events and things that inspire me. And so a song flew out of me, and I called it She's the First. I got a team of wonderful producers to produce it with me, and then gifted them the song, saying that all the proceeds would go directly to their scholarship. Well, then we made a beautiful music video featuring a lot of their girls, and suddenly they were the ones moved to tears. I've always believed that music is such a powerful medium. Ever since I was 7 years old, this is me at the piano writing my first song, I told myself it was my mission to have my music reach as many people as possible and for it to be a healing tool. This is me at 10, my first recital. Couldn't hold the sax, and then I was singing. This is the first time in the studio, writing songs and playing saxophone. But I truly believe that. I believe music is this incredible vibrational force, and it brings us all together. We sing songs in celebration, we sing songs in despair, and sometimes when we don't have the words to speak it, we can still sing it and get our emotion across. So all of a sudden, this song, She's the First, was reaching even more people than the organization. And messages were coming in, some from girls around the globe who were singing the song every day as they walked to school. They used it as their anthem and through all the hardships they were facing. I had a message from someone saying it was her 5K marathon song run, and she played it as she crossed the finish line. Others telling me it was the song on repeat that helped them get through the election. And with every message that came in, it brought so much joy to my heart. And a very interesting thing happened. I had a very subconscious shift, and I realized my anxiety and pain habits and OCD were at an all-time low, and I was feeling great. And I was realizing that if I can just follow my bliss and bring that positive change with the gift that I was born with, then I can feel more at ease. And it was by focusing on the outside world, the bigger world outside of myself, that ultimately gave me that divine inspiration and insight. Well, I've learned to say yes and then figure it out. And I welcome openness and flexibility into my life. And I try to think, what's the worst that can happen, instead of, this may not work out. And to rock it with confidence, because I know I got over the hump before, so I can do it again. And I'm learning that it's a good thing to be uncomfortable, because that means that growth is happening. But most importantly, I'm learning to define success for myself. We live in a world that's obsessed with a number of like Facebook likes that you get. But my real success is following my bliss, giving 100%, being in the music, and all those other things, awards, fame, money, adoration. Well, that's a byproduct of doing something that I love and hopefully do well. I'm mindful every day of scarcity and fear, and I really try to focus those thoughts instead on my own uniqueness and positivity. I've got my own thing. Suddenly, I'm not the one chasing the fad. I want to be the one creating it with my own ideas. There's no other Grace Kelly. Well, I love her. So I just wanted to say to all of you today, to follow your bliss. Find your inspiration. Find that thing that just like lights you up. And the next time a monumental opportunity comes around that you think you're not ready for, you think, I need more time, I just don't know, I urge you to just take another second and consider it and say yes. Maybe you're not ready for it, but say yes. Because I bet you are. And you know, the word impossible does spell out I'm possible. And you may just surprise yourself. Thank you guys so much for listening. I'll be outside later today, and I'm excited to meet all of you inspiring people. So I hope those are some helpful words, and thank you.